Moshe, it's so good to see you. When I woke up on Saturday morning, the first thing I wanted to do was no more. And secondly, to reach out to my friends and ask them, knowing that they would be so powerfully affected by what had taken place. When I reached out to you, you said, you know, you had lots of thoughts, and I would like to ask you to share those thoughts in this conversation. So take me back to Saturday, and we'll look at Israeli history and Arab history as well. But first, the moment that we're in and the significance of it.
Well, you know, like many of us, woke up Saturday morning, total shock. For an Israeli, the shock is, how could that have possibly happened? How could they have just breached that wall and poured in unresisted and butchered the population in our, 100-year history of the conflict? And there have been many massacres and butcheries. That has not happened.
How do you characterize your own place?
Well, you know, I'm 85. I was born into the making of the state. I was 10 when the state came to be.
So you were born in 1938 in Haifa.
Correct. And I was immersed with the ideology of socialist Zionism. I also think that my exposure since then and my travels and my life in Canada and America immersed with, I think, deep humanism. I don't know quite how to put it, but a set of values that represented the making of Israel. Not that it hadn't have contradictions in terms of the relationship with the Palestinians from day one, from the days maybe of the Balfour Declaration, but nevertheless, we had a set of values of social responsibility, a worldview which we associate the word socialism no longer has a clear definition. It's a worldview in which we live with a level of concern and commitment to the rest of society and humanity, and in which we believe profoundly that all people have been made equal. You know, that you know, the life of an Arab is equal to the life of a Jew, the life of anyone. And so this government that befell upon us is just like a deep wound and shock and moment of reevaluation.
Let me interject a couple of things about that, because as the audience knows, and you clearly know, you know, there was also a fear, in a sense, that certain military people and certain reservists, you know, did not want to be called up for an autocratic government, or a government that was not democratic. And there was that before this happened. You know, the nation and everyone else has rallied behind the government, as you might expect when you had this kind of barbarism and this kind of invasion and this kind of threat.
Yeah, there was never any question about that, Charlie. I mean, when they said, we will not, they're broken the contract with the people. We did not, this is a people's army, and we did not contract with a government that is a dictatorship that has removed the power of the court to affect our life. They were saying this, we can't, we do not feel that we want to abide by a government who might, will make decisions that we might not respect in serving in the army. But there was never doubt in my mind that in the international emergency, they'll be there.
And they are.
The reality has been is that they have been there. They have saved the day. Not only have they been there because this incompetent government did a number, made a number of both policy and tactical moves in the past few months that led us to this disaster. Number one, they have been building up Hamas, letting money flow to Hamas from Qatar, saying, oh, they are now resigned in Gaza. We need to give them more work permits so that the economy improves, and we let them money from Qatar, and they're not going to bother us at this point. And which was, you know, cynical way of saying, we're going to reinforce Hamas so we'll weaken the PLO so that we can do in the West Bank what we want, because rather have a Hamas in Gaza, we're interested in the West Bank. Yeah. And that is cynical, and it came to haunt us. Secondly, just before the Festival of Sukkot, they moved an entire division from Gaza to the West Bank to protect the crazy settlers who were doing celebrations in various tombs and sites that were right at the heart of the Palestinian population, and they were guarding them and exposing the border in Gaza, which might have been very well known to the Hamas.
You seem to be saying, Moshe, you seem to be saying that there is a direct connection between what this government that had made a deal between Benjamin Netanyahu and right parties and religious parties had taken its eye off the security element and was more focused on judicial reform, as they characterized it, and that it had in that process weakened and made the government of Israel more complacent about protecting its citizens.
I'm saying that, yes, and one more thing, that in its obsession and dedication to taking over and annexing the West Bank and taking over more and more land from Palestinians in the West Bank, they invested money, energy, and the military in the West Bank at the expense of protecting the Gaza border. As a consequence of those policies, this right-wing government has been so obsessed, Ben-Gvir and Smotrich, with the settlers, with the kind of horrific acts that they were having against Palestinians all over, harassing them, attacking them, and therefore having to be protected because there was exposure of all those settlers. And that, both that and both the judiciary reform, which upset so many Israelis in key positions and also reserve soldiers, weakened the situation and weakened the country's ability to deal with things.
Tom Friedman writing in this morning's New York Times.
God bless Tom Friedman. Thank goodness for his writing. It's been a very important voice.
Both in terms of its opposition to what's happening in Israel and his opposition to the prime minister.
Yes.
He has, in fact, said, if I'm correct, he thinks that Prime Minister Netanyahu is, in fact, one of the worst prime ministers that Israel has had.
The worst. I've known them all.
You cannot watch the barbarism without understanding how so many people are filled with the idea of revenge when they think about and see on video the kinds of atrocities that took place. So how do you feel about the fact that there are at this moment troops and tanks lining up on the border of Gaza, and the government has made a decision or is considering a decision
to invade
and occupy?
To go in. Look, I do feel that after what has happened, Hamas has to be eliminated as an organization.
If eliminated, not contained, eliminated.
Eliminated. In the long run, has to be eliminated. I mean, you know, you try and pull back and say, can one see it from the Palestinian perspective? Let's try and see it from the Palestinian perspective. I always put myself in the other side's position in this conflict from day one. I always said, what about the other side? Well, we have provoked. Israel has provoked in the West Bank. Israel has provoked in the past year actions by the settlers that have really heated the scene and the relationship, and has been extremely upsetting to the Palestinians.
But you would be the first to acknowledge that nothing like that has happened, as bad as it might have been, justifies the kind of terrorism.
No,
kind of...
absolutely not. I'm just saying. What I'm just trying to pull back. So there's been provocation. Now, also, no doubt, if you look at the past 10 years, Gaza has suffered a great deal, and Israel has, you know, put the screws on, because every time it had to react to Hamas actions. So basically, if you look back at the history of Hamas, they have not been a concerned and compassionate representatives of the population of Gaza.
And have not used the funds that they were given in order to benefit that population, it is argued.
Absolutely, absolutely. The money pouring from Gaza, from Qatar and other places, has gone to building tunnels, to arming, to training, not to the people. They have set up all the headquarters, the missile sites, and every other military operation in schools, in hospitals, in mosques. You know, a leadership that cares about the population just does not do that. They don't give a damn for the population of the West Bank. The fact that the population, some of them still support them, we don't even know if they support them. We have no idea. But Hamas has proven to be destructive to its own people, and certainly brutal and, you know, primitively uncivilized towards Israel. These actions have been just horrific that have taken place. So Hamas has to be eliminated. At the same time, they have a lot of hostages, children, women, old people, some soldiers. Do you write them off? Because if you go after the Hamas and eliminate them, they'll probably all be killed. It's a very tough moment of decision making.
But you have
to. Do you negotiate that?
But leadership means having to make tough decisions. I mean, what do you want
the
leadership to decide? You know, having expressed the concerns that you have about how this government has acted with respect to the West Bank and elsewhere and on certain issues, what do you want now to happen? Do you want them to go into Gaza? Because Tom Friedman expressed this idea that you should ask yourself, what is it that the enemy would like for me to do, and not do that? And
I would not go into Gaza right now.
Because of the hostages, or because it would lead
not to only, war? Not only.
Because it would lead to larger war?
I think that the Air Force, without going to Gaza, can inflict on Hamas considerable damage. I think that there should be discussions to free the hostages and pay the price of releasing thousands of Palestinian prisoners. You know, we should remember that Tanya, who leads the Hamas, was a prisoner in Israel and was released in the deal that was made in exchange for the soldier Shalit
right.
some years back.
Almost 1,000 to 1.
That's right. So I think that probably should take place, but there has to be a much longer term policy that leads to the elimination of Hamas. So I think there's a timetable. The question is a timetable. You know, what happens when? I mean, I don't envy those who have to make those decisions.
Well, speaking of timetable, others, including military people, when the question is raised, was there an intelligence failure? Everybody seems to say, that's an important question. We have to ask that. Probably a commission will be established, but it's not now the time. Now is the time to look after the security of Israel and try to get those hostages back. And thirdly, to do something about the elimination of Hamas as a terrorist organization.
The elimination of Hamas has to occur. And in parallel, there has to be some plan for creating a regime in Gaza that can start uplifting life there, you know, opening it up, giving it access from the world.
But let
me... Hand in hand. I mean, you got to eliminate Hamas and you got to follow it up with a serious program of reconstruction under some regime, possibly under the Palestinian Authority, bringing them back there.
Well, but you know the issue that is raised when you speak of the Palestinian Authority, it has to do with the corruption and
its weakness. Yes, of course I am.
Yes. Let me...
So, I mean, there are some suggestions of setting up some kind of regime of temporary stewardship of Egypt and Saudi Arabia and some other countries, just a temporary regime that will maintain some security and begin a process of rebuilding the place. I mean, in the long run, 2 million people need to have reasonable conditions of life for this situation to long-term become at peace.
You have a home in Jerusalem. You know,
yes,
and have been part of the history of Israel, having been born there and then moved to Canada when you were a teenager, but maintained a home there and offices and other things around the world. Do you think this is a moment that will change Israel in the same way that after the Yom Kippur War, Golda Meir resigned?
I really am hopeful, and I mean, I'm very hopeful that the outcome of this war might be some fundamental reconsideration on the Israeli side at several levels. I mean, the Yom Kippur War gave us the peace with Egypt.
Right.
Egypt, who had been humiliated in the Six-Day War, was able and ready to make peace. This conflict will have deep impact on Israel. I think the forces of sanity and those who have been protesting will prevail because they saved the day now. They are the ones who saved the day. And, you know, nothing was more interesting, you know, representative of our situation, that there were hundreds of young men in Athens, Israelis, gathering from all over the world, waiting to be shuttled back to Israel, and hundreds of religious young men at Ben Gurion Airport, waiting to be shuttled back to New York 2 days ago, escaping the country. That's our dilemma. And this is going to change things in Israel profoundly. But beyond that, what I'm hoping is that this might be a new chapter in terms of coming to some broader resolution of the Arab Israel, of the Palestinian Israeli conflict.
Well, you're in favor of you're in favor of a two-state solution.
I actually have evolved my position about the term two-state solution. I am for a two-state solution, but I recognize that a two-state solution with the asymmetry of power and control over fundamental elements such as resources, security, etc., is a bit of a sham. Because two-state solution in which the two states have full sovereignty is not really possible to achieve at this point when you recognize that sovereignty means control over all aspects of civil life. So I'm kind of feeling that the solution is two states under a federated structure, where the Palestinians... go ahead.
I mean, the question is, you know, often presented as a dilemma for Israel. It either has to remain a Jewish state, or B, it has to be a democracy and lose that.
There's no question in my mind, Charlie, about that. Israel has to not control Palestinian population, be a Jewish democratic state. And by the way, I would reverse it, democratic Jewish state, because there's aspect of Jewish law, at least Orthodox Jewish law, which are anti-democratic. So first democratic, then Jewish. But Jewish in terms of demography, although we have 20% of the population which should be full, which are full and should be full citizens with every privilege that every other Israeli has. However, I think that the Palestinian population in Gaza and the West Bank need full control of their lives, and we should not occupy them. And to my mind, the solution at this point is to have Israel, Palestinian state, with some kind of a joint federal structure about resources, about security, about foreign affairs, because if you think about resources such as water and energy, if you think about transportation, if you think about even controlling epidemics and so on, this cannot be separated. It's all intertwined, and it's all in a very small territory. Can the Palestinians and the Israelis come to the point of trust that they can jointly somehow govern these things together while each country is governing its own immediate affairs? That's why I say a federated structure. And I can see Jordan joining that over time. And it all would fit in within the sort of regional peace that seems to be emerging.
Well, that raises the very important question, which you just indicated by your last statement. This terrible attack comes at a time that at the United States is urging Saudi Arabia and Israel. We're having serious conversations.
Maybe because of it. Maybe the attack comes because of it.
Well, that's my point. That's the question I'm asking.
Yeah.
What do you think? I mean, you not only...
Oh, I think no doubt that to the extent that this has been all influenced by Iran, and even the Palestinians themselves, the rapprochement that has been emerging between Saudi Arabia and Israel, and the debate, I don't think it helped that there was a debate whether the Palestinians would get anything out of it, was one of the causes of the timing of the attack.
Well, it's I mean, you could argue that it was much more a sense of Iran not wanting to see Israel and
Yes,
Saudi Arabia.
no doubt.
Iran, notwithstanding.
Iran first, for sure. And Iran controls
that Iran feared, because one of the reasons they were coming together was in mutual hostility to Iran.
I think for sure Iran contributed to the timing of this attack. And if, of course, we think to its planning as well, but certainly to its timing.
When, I hate to use cliches, but when push comes to shove, are you more than hopeful, a little optimistic, that something good can come out of this?
Charlie, I'm such an optimist. I've been all my life that I'm very hopeful. I think the big forces, if you just think in the macro, this conflict increasingly doesn't make sense. In the sense, it doesn't make sense because if you look at the slow evolution of things, Israeli Arabs have increasingly been integrating into Israeli society. You know, half of the hospitals are staffed by, half of the doctors in the hospitals are Arab Israelis in Israel. Not to understate the fact that they have not had full privileges and opportunities. Nevertheless, there is an evolution here where prosperity and the sort of underlying elements of what can make a society work make it possible for this for change. And yet there's hardliners on the Palestinian side and on the Israeli side that are sort of resisting that because they just play the everything or nothing game. But
and,
I think
and because
that
and because they may believe that they will have no position of power within that kind of rapprochement.
You mean they fear
exactly.
Not having, yeah. Well, it's more than that too. There's on the Israeli side, the messianic sort of belief that, this all the land should be ours. Well, all the land can only be ours if there's no Palestinians in it. And on the Arab side, there's the still dream of let's eliminate Israel and kill every Jew and get our land back. So it's just like extremists whose vision is not attainable under any circumstances anymore. And so you just hope that the more moderate voices start prevailing, given so many violent acts that seem to get everyone nowhere.
You're in Boston. I'm not sure. I don't know whether you still teach at the Harvard School of Design, but you haven't.
I still do intermittently. Yes.
Okay. There have been on your campus and other campuses pro-Hamas. I want to define this carefully, but there have been demonstrations against Israel, so much that the president of Harvard was delayed but found it necessary to speak out. What do you think of that?
I think it fascinates me to the extent to which young people, particularly young students, have developed this somewhat imbalanced view of things. They set up two standards, one that Israel needs to perform by, and a much more tolerant standard for what the Palestinians need to be judged by. And I don't need to go to Harvard I have these discussions with my young daughter, who,
What does she say?
Youngest daughter. You know, she has feelings of deep criticism of Israel's conduct vis-a-vis the Palestinians. I'm not talking about this moment of war, but just ongoing in the West Bank, the fact that there's occupation, but without a balancing of the history of the violence. Look, we were in Gaza, we controlled it, we pulled out, Sharon pulled out. What did we get? Missiles. So without accounting for the history of violence and deep insecurity that forces Israel to have to still maintain some systems that assure safety. And if anything proves that, it's the last few days. The least loosening up of this security belt, and look what happens. And that balance between these two is not understood by this generation of young students. They just set up these two contradictory standards without acknowledging the threat and the history of violence that comes the other way. And so it's sad for me that this is the case. Some people assign it to anti-Semitism. I don't know.
Well, but you do know. I mean, you're a man of the world. Is anti-Semitism on the rise?
No doubt about it. But no doubt about it. It's on the rise. And I think that our former president contributed a great deal to it in the United States. And I think, you know, I've been in dinners in England, in London, in Europe, you know, where you hear these criticisms that of Israel, which without question in my mind are very tinted with deeply rooted anti-Semitism.
And what's to be done about it?
I think I can only answer that for Israel. Israel has to become, as we say in Hebrew, Or Lagoyim, a light unto the nations. I think the more Israel behaves and demonstrates this kind of principle or philosophy, it'll help reduce anti-Semitism.
Okay,
but
so let
what
me,
we do
let,
about anti-Semitism,
let me focus on that.
I mean, look, there's anti-Semitism in China and they don't even know what a Jew looks like. It's very complex and deep-rooted.
Yes, and also anti-Muslim and as well.
Yes.
When you talk to your friends in Israel, do they agree with you in terms of what should be done at the moment? Or are they divided? Or do they agree?
I think what should be done in the moment is a paradox that we're all struggling with together. There isn't an easy answer. You know, we talked about going in on land, destroying them immediately, negotiating for the hostages, you know, which comes first. And I think the notion that long-term Hamas has to be eradicated is pretty well a consensus at this moment. Nobody's saying, you know, they can be contained or we can continue living with them. At this point, the consensus is they've just got to be eradicated,
in the same way that there was a consensus that ISIS had to be eliminated.
Correct. It's very much, there's a parallel there because the rules of the game that Hamas operates by, their deep disconcern for their own people in terms of actions. It's not what they say, but in terms of their action, deep disconcern for their own people and brutality towards Israel, they just got to be eliminated. And I think there is consensus about that. The rest is all about tactics.
My question is, at this moment, understanding the history of Israel, is this a moment that Israel can somehow balance its need, understandable need, to take out Hamas, call it revenge, call it vengeance, call it justice, whatever you want to call it? Can it do that and at the same time take this moment in which there is a possibility of having a significant level of support from around the world, with exceptions, obviously Iran, obviously Russia spoke yesterday and said nothing. But Israel stands at a moment that it has to do things that speak to the security of its people, yet at the same time,
yes,
it has the world's attention and possible support.
I believe this is the big challenge that faces Israel right now, that how to eradicate Hamas with a level of compassion and concern for its population. Personally, I think it's a mistake to stop the water and the food. It's a mistake. This kind of collective punishment is not going to go very far in eradicating Hamas. And if it's intended to create suffering that will reverse the population towards Hamas, that's not going to happen. So I think the focus has to be on all the actions that contribute to the destruction of Hamas with maximum caution for the population. It's a very tough, tough thing to achieve, which is why I believe that the current government has to be supplemented by the voices of what has been the opposition to join the government into an emergency government, because we need these other voices to navigate the country to achieve that.
Where is the young leadership? Are they there?
Well, the young leadership
has changed so that they've been outvoted by others. I mean, they don't have to be of the Labour Party. They can be of Likud. They can be of other parties.
The young leadership emerged through the protest movement. It was amazing to see individuals like Bressler,
right,
who left her high-tech, highly paid, high-tech position and became the leader of the protest movement in an extraordinary way. And there's others in that movement. And they are the voice of the future of Israel. And I hope that this series of events beginning earlier in the year and the protest movement and this war at this moment are going to propel them into the next generation of leadership.
And let me ask one final question. Tell me what Israel means to you.
To me, Israel is home and a country that I feel I'm very committed to. And I keep hoping and dreaming that it will be a light unto the nations, that it will become an exemplary country, which people look up to in terms of its achievements and its values and its conduct in the world and it's the contribution of its citizens to society and to the world as a whole.
Well, thank you for sharing that. And also at this incredible moment in the history of Israel, in the history of the Middle East, in the history, you know, the whole world is watching this moment. And it has tragedy and it has, hopefully,
a painful moment.
It's a painful moment, but let's hopefully hope somewhere in there, there is hope. I thank you very much, my
thank
friend.
You.
Hope to see you soon.
Thank you.